Hey everyone, I've got something very special to share with you all today. I have three, count that, three rapid infusers in my office. All of them have various problems, but because I have to test them and I have to open them and check them anyway, I figure I might as well share it with you guys. So let's take a look at the level one rapid infusers. Alright guys, here's the infamous level 1 rapid infusers. I know I've hit on them before. You can see this one here is set up as they would use it. They have the saline bag in there, the patient line. Down here you have a consumable tube that snaps in. This pushes down. And this is a bifurcated tube, so there's an inner chamber and an outer chamber. The inner chamber is your patient line, which comes up from up here, goes down into here, and it flows through it while it's being heated. This tube's very warm. You can see that it is 41 degrees. Comes down here, we have a bubble catcher, a drip chamber, and down next to it, that Smith's, that is a pinch valve, and I'm not really sure if this is an ultrasonic and detects air bubbles or not, but it is a pinch valve, so if this guy gives any errors, like fluid out or whatnot, it clamps off your patient line so that you're not going to have to bleed out the air next time you load a saline. So this is a traditional setup. You see we have these two chambers. There's a bag that sits inside it, a bladder, and your saline will get loaded, much like this one. Let's take a look. See, I got a saline bag up in there. And then this acrylic lid will close on top of it, and this latches, and then we hit the plus at the top. I'm not gonna do it that one because I'll have fluid all over. Okay guys, you can see right here I've got it on the plus. I'm pressurizing the bladder, which normally would be squeezing on my saline bag, and this goes really quickly, by the way. When you activate the pressure and start squeezing the pressure, it will empty that bag in seconds. So here I've got one. You can see it's up to about 260 millimeters of mercury. And that's one of the checks that we do. We'll go into that in just a moment. But we check to make sure that these don't have leaks. And you see how I hit the minus? It drains pressure from the reservoir so I can open it safely. Load a next saline bag. Close the lid. Pressurize it. So you guys have heard me talk about rapid infusers before. These are used to distribute infusibles like blood products or saline into the patient when they're bleeding out. And the reason you do that is because when the blood pressure decreases, the heart rate goes up, your body starts releasing chemicals to try and compensate, and it will also segregate blood from appendages, which your head is an appendage. So you will actually pass out and stuff because blood will drain away from the brain because it's trying to conserve blood into your chest area to keep the body alive. Side effect. So what they do is they try to get blood products, specifically items like saline, because saline is it's an electrolyte. And the heart fires and the brain fires based on closing the snaps between nerves, which it's an electrical signal. It needs an electrolyte to go from nerve to nerve. And anybody that's had like Charlie horses, because they've been outside sweating quite a bit and you got all that salt built up on your skin from the sweat, get some salt in you. Drink some Gatorade, because you will get the eye quivers, you will get Charlie horses and stuff like that because you are deficient in electrolytes. So that's one of the things that we're doing, is we are injecting electrolyte into your patient, or blood products like platelets or RBCs, red blood cells, whatever. But this guy here is the machine that does it. So let's continue taking a look at the functionality of this machine. Okay, so now that you know how and why it's used, you see I've got the two reservoirs on this guy. I currently have it set up. It's running at its normal operating temperature. It's 41 degrees C. You guys know that 37 degrees C is normal body temperature. Down here for the functionality, you can test the over temperature. This is power, this is shut off. Down here to load your hose into the pinch valve. Just make sure it's up and in there really good. Latch the door, there you go. And it'll show you a green light. You're good to go, ready to start. So these are a water reservoir heater. And any of you guys that have been Biomeds for a while, you know that there are stringent regulations on water reservoir heaters because they have a tendency of developing certain strains of bacteria and fungi if they're not sanitized regularly. So these guys have a pretty stringent PM policy, and I've read different versions of PMs over the years. We're not gonna exactly go into a PM because obviously that could date this video really quickly if they decide to change their procedures. But anyway, this one here is a unit that's under test. You can see right here, I've got the thermometer in line, and I have a little closed loop test jig down here that there's a micro switch right here. See that little guy? So there's a micro switch, and then there's a micro switch right up in here in this guy. And you can see I just made it very upset. So it's gonna do a check on the line. Okay. Push this guy in and it will auto cycle and it'll start feeding. So if you ever have a rookie that's working on these, one of the fun things to tell them to do is to tell them to hit the green button, and then when he says it's not doing anything, tell them to press the micro switch right here and the micro switch right here. Tell them to just put one hand on one and one hand on the other and push in those buttons, to which it'll instantly shoot water all over the room. It's kind of funny to do, but anyway. So that is the functionality. That is the testing, part of the testing of one of these guys. Let's take a look at the inside of one of these guys and see what makes them tick. So you can see right here, AC power comes in, goes through a industrial fuse setup, and then it comes up here to a power supply slash control board. It's all in one board on these guys. Does have a series of fuses. I've never had to change out a fuse in these, but we have had many leaks. This acrylic line right here, I've had it crack, and if it cracks, you can trim off the hose, raise it up, install a little junction down here that goes into your tank and press on. You'll have tank leaks on some of these if they've had impact damage. This reservoir right here is really good. But if you take a look down here, there's some evidence of something else going on. So right here, I think that these units have two heaters. There's one in the back and there's one right here. They're elongated. Right here is a thermal cutoff. And right back there's a thermal cutoff. And I don't know enough about this unit to determine if those turn on and turn off like resettable fuses, or if they're permanent cutoff safety fuses for temperature overload. I don't really know, but anyway, they're there. Here I have a water pump. Notice we have a fan. So I always check the fan to make sure that the fan's not all gummed up. That helps keep your water pump nice and cool. Up here, we have the air pump. So that's gonna be the other check for these machines, is there is a 300 millimeters of mercury, and they labeled it, you see right there on the back of the unit. And that 300 millimeters of mercury is what goes up to the reservoirs. So the 300 millimeters of mercury is what comes up to the reservoirs right here, so that you can pressurize the bags of saline or whatever. And that comes in right here, and you see this little guy right here? This is your pressure regulator for the pump. The pump will keep going and going and going, building pressure until mechanically it just gives out. This guy is actually an overpressure. So what I'll do is I'll hook my manometer up to this guy right here. You turn the unit on, it immediately goes to pumping air, and you set your 300 millimeters right here by this guy. I have had to do that before. So anyway, besides the leaks and besides setting the air pressure, the other unit that's going to give you issues are your pressure chambers. Either because you will have a leak in your bag right here, your bladder, or because you will have a leak someplace in line. So right here is the line. You can see I've got it disconnected. And let's take a look inside one of these, because there are some things that you can do. So as soon as the air goes in, you notice right here, I have a check valve. It comes up here where it's distributed. This is a slider valve. See right there on the plus and minus? This will actually just slide back and forth over a couple different O-rings, and it'll either vent the atmosphere or it'll go in this clear line down to your bladder. And you can see over here, I've got a couple other things going on. One of them right there, that is your millimeters of mercury analog gauge right there on the front. And this guy right here is your overpressure or your pressure adjustment for your bladder. So in case it goes over 300 millimeters of mercury, this guy here will vent to atmosphere just naturally, spring pressure. So a couple of things that I've had to do in these guys before is you can test your check valve, and you do that simply. You guys have seen me, I've done videos on these guys before. This is a vital signs pressure bag that they use in anesthesia. And all I do is Y in a piece of tubing, which will connect here, pump up the pressure on this guy, and then you'll go ahead and shut it off here. So you shut it off and isolate the reservoir, and just take a look. And you can watch the bleed down based on how fast it is. That's how fast your leak is. This particular unit, as soon as we opened it up, this guy right here fell out. This just presses in, but it fell out. And that is where the leak was. Conveniently enough, I have had other times where I've had to adjust that valve right there. And I've had other times where I've had to adjust the scale. See that screw right there? That will adjust the needle and the offset of the analog gauge. So what we're gonna do is with my digital manometer, I'll inflate this guy to 300 or let's say 250 millimeters of mercury. I'll close it off so that we keep it at 200, and then I'll adjust the scale on that tiny little screw on the back until it matches up to the 200. And that's how we set it and calibrate it. So when you slide this guy over to the minus, it then goes over here and it vents it to atmosphere, relieving the pressure. At no time does air go backwards this way from one reservoir to the other because of the check valve. So I could actually maintain pressure, keep it on plus while the other cylinder is going. Because in other words, if you popped a hole in one bag, it would leak pressure from this bag. But with that check valve, we don't have that problem. So that's it, guys. That is a rough overview of the level one rapid infuser. And I could go into more detail, but I don't really think it's necessary. There's a lot of troubleshooting that you can do with these. It's a lot like a dental chair, and there's a lot of hit or miss type of areas that you can check. But using that general overview, you should know roundabout where you have to adjust. Now just section it off when you're troubleshooting. If you have a leak, check your 300 millimeters of mercury that's coming out the back of the unit. If you have it, then go ahead and isolate one of your pressure chambers at the top. Fill them up, and then when you fill it up, shut it off and then watch the leak. It's that simple, guys. So that is the level one rapid infuser. Thanks for watching, guys.